Ancient words, ever true, changing me.
Righteousness, and it's all.
my lips. Here I am. With my people who are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray. I ask you, has your tongue become humble? When your tongue becomes humble, then your lips have been cleansed from covering by the fire. For before the throne of God, and who can tame the tongue? Who can tame the tongue? It shall be done with the coals of fire. I spoke to you that I would visit you and be test of your heritage. To test if you would be humble. And with it will come the coals.
Bonnie's going to preach for us today, glory to God. And where two or three are gathered together, there he is in the midst of us.
Yes.
I want to remind everybody, December the 3rd, Friday, is Tim Sherbeck's funeral. And Jenny finished up the programs, and we worked on them. And then she got it to the printer, so I've got them here today. And then the next Sunday, of course, is our family day. And then the 7th, we'll be over at the mansion. So we've got a lot going on. So, but right now, Miss Bonnie's been working on this for a while. She told me some months back she was working on it. And God gave her the full revelation. So, Bonnie, we're looking forward to this.
Amen. Carolyn suggested that I present my study to you on Psalm 23. It's an honor that she trusts me enough to stand behind this podium this Sunday. I would share that when you do a study, you know that you get a lot of information, and it's determining what information you're going to share. So I think the most challenging part of this was once I got over that I was speaking today, what of the myriad of information I've gathered, what was I going to keep hidden, what gems? So I'm pretty sure you don't want to be here for several hours, so I've tried to condense this down. I've been told that Psalm 23 is known as a funeral song. Traditionally, it's recited when they're moving the casket from the memorial service to the place where the casket's going to be buried. I was surprised to discover that Psalm 23 is part of a trilogy of Psalms, which describes three specific roles of the Messiah. Psalm 22, it's the rejection and suffering of Jesus Christ, and it begins with the Lord on the cross and ends with his resurrection. Psalm 23, our dwelling in his presence and the Lord's role in our daily life. And then there's Psalm 24, the last period of man on earth when the king comes to claim his kingdom. Psalm 23 103 is one of the best known psalms, and it's quoted scripture from the Bible, and it describes our relationship with the Savior. He makes me, he leads me, he restores me, he guides me, he is with me, he is, he comforts me, he prepares me, and he anoints me. Psalm 23 also reveals God's characteristics. It's believed by rabbis that Psalm 23 was composed by David while on the run from King Saul, who was intent on murdering him. David was hiding on the brink of death, without food, without drink, and was miraculously saved by God. The story of salvation. King David, the author, would intimately be familiar with the roles and responsibilities of a shepherd. He was one in his youth, and he submitted to the great shepherd. When God wants to convey his compassion towards us, he uses the imagery of the shepherd. According to ancient rabbis, David alludes to how God provided for the Jews every need throughout their 40-year sojourn in the desert, and how they will sing when God returns them to their holy land. It is said that David sang, not just for himself, but for every Jew. So I'm going to go through each verse here. And the first one we're looking at is, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And he's talking about provision. Let's start with the beginning. The Lord is. He is the great I am. David was referring to God who was, God who is, and the God who will always be. My shepherd. We have a personal relationship with God. I shall not want. I will not be lacking in anything. It doesn't mean that I don't want anything. It means that I don't have need of anything. I shall not lack food. I shall not lack finances. I shall not lack health. I shall not lack success. In the NIV version, "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing." That's how it's phrased there. The Hebrew word is chesed, something that is incomplete, insufficient, or empty. It is the same word that Moses spoke of when he was talking about the Israelites in the wilderness and how the 40 years Yahweh, your God, has been with you. You have lacked, chesed, nothing. That's in Deuteronomy 2:7. Even though the Israelites had traveled for years throughout the mostly barren wilderness, God provided food, water, clothing, provision, guidance, and protection. Everything that they needed. They lacked nothing. And remember, we had the same God. Verse 2. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He's talking about rest. He makes me. God does not force us. He causes us to desire it. It's kind of funny because you can't make a sheep do anything. We have free will. Make actually means to be suitable for. It doesn't mean that he forces us. It means that we were made for this. David expressed that there are times that we, his sheep, are unwilling to stop and rest. And it may be that he may have to strongly encourage us to rest. You know, because of the pandemic, many of us have been forced to stop and evaluate what we are doing with our lives. I, for one, needed it. I needed to take a step back. I needed to slow down. But I found myself thinking, why did I need this rest? Have I been in God's will? Have I been doing what God desires me to do? Or was I making my own plans? Where was I spending my energy? To lie down. In the Hebrew word, rabatz, it implies a crouching, resting position. In a state of relaxation, it implies no fear of predators or starvation. Philip Keller served as a shepherd for many years, and he said that sheep have four things that they need before they lie down. Freedom from fear, freedom from friction within the flock, freedom from parasites, and freedom from hunger. I don't think we're much different. Green pastures. Green pastures means food in a resting place. God helps us find rest and refreshment. This is where God feeds us. It is food to sustain the physical body, but also provide comfort for the soul. One of the shepherd's most important tasks was searching out the green pastures and calm watering holes for the sheep. The Hebrew word for pastures means habitation, but it's also used for home. One of the greatest needs of the world right now is food. People are hungry in the body of Christ, and they're hungry to learn about Jesus Christ. He leads me beside the still waters. He's speaking about peace. He leads me. This verb, leads, has a meaning that means gently and carefully to provide protection and substance. Beside, al is a Hebrew word here, and it frequently uses a preposition meaning upon or over something. The still waters. Sheep easily get spooked. If the waters are too wild and too strong, they prefer still waters rather than rapid streams. In this verse, the Hebrew word for still is a quiet place of rest, and the waters is a plural word. The role of the shepherd is to guide the flock to food and water, to protect them from any predators or thieves that might be about. The same way Yahweh protects us and provides for food and water for the people and protects us from our enemies. While sheep can survive eating dry grass, they will prosper only by eating green grass. It is the green grass that is tastier and more nutritious, but it also contains moisture to sustain the sheep when the water is unavailable. When the sheep are thirsty, they become restless, and they set out in search of water to satisfy their thirst. If not led to a good water supply, they will often drink from a polluted water hole where they can pick up parasites and other diseases. Doesn't this remind you of the church? Verse 3, it speaks of restoration. He restoreth my soul. Restore is a verb meaning to turn, to return, going back somewhere that you have been before. We know this as repentance. Soul, as you know, means mind, will, and emotions. But there's more here. The Hebrew word here is nefesh, or breath. It is derived from a verb that means to breathe and to be refreshed, getting your breath back after being winded. This is the same as in Genesis 2:7, when God breathed into man's nostrils and created life. This also refers to blood, because blood is another force necessary for life. The Israelites thought of a person holistically and would never have divided the person into body and soul, as the Greeks did. They could not have conceived a soul apart from a body, or a soul continuing to live after a body died. We probably don't think of sheep as having a soul that needs restoring. However, we translate the Jewish word nephs to mean life, which is what it meant to the Jewish people. This verse becomes clearer. Like every living creature, sheep periodically find themselves in physical or emotional turmoil and need their lives restored. I think we all can relate to that. In other words, there's nothing you can do that's too bad for God to forgive. Apparently, if a sheep accidentally rolls over on its back, it has no way to restore their footing and is likely to be fatal unless a shepherd intervenes. This is why shepherds need to keep an accurate count of their sheep. We've all heard that God knows even the number of hairs on their head, right? Once a shepherd finds the cast sheep, he must help it get back on its feet, which, interesting, They may require some massaging of the sheep's numb muscles until they're restored. Likewise, we too need to be restored. We all have pains and wounds from the past that threaten to color our thoughts, bring us into sickness, and cause us depression or sadness. But the Lord heals us, and he makes us new. Life has its ups and downs, and we need the Lord's guidance and restoration. People in the up stage are tempted to become prideful and help avoid, and God tries to help us avoid self-destructing. And people in the down stage, they become physically or emotionally needful, and God has to intervene. We all need restoration and salvation at one time or another. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Hi, Jetta. Verse 3, he leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Here we have guidance. He leads me. This lead is actually different than the word we used previously in the upper verse. It means to guide someone to an unfamiliar place. Paths of righteousness. Each time a sheep goes around the hill, and I put a picture up here so you can see this, around the hill, they come up slightly higher than the previous path each time that they travel. The feet of the sheep create a pathway. These paths are called paths of righteousness. The paths of righteousness are actually paths that Israeli shepherds would lead their sheep on. And when they get to the top, it's called tikva, meaning hope. Israel's national anthem is HaTikva, the hope. Righteousness is life according with God's laws and God's will. Righteousness means correct and right, and is derived from a verb meaning to be right. These right paths lead to life rather than death. Matthew 7:13-14. Paths are visible. It's a sign that others have successfully made it, and should it be an encouragement to us. For his name's sake, the word name means name, but it's often used in a sense of person's fame or reputation. Sake is an adverb meaning on account of or in order that, and that comes from the root meaning to pay attention. He will guide me down the well-worn paths in the correct direction because this is his character and reputation. Verse 4, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. He talks about security here. Take note that he's used in Psalm 23:1-3 changes to you. The Lord as the shepherd is now the second person. The word through is important here. David doesn't speak of going into the valley as if it were a box canyon or a final destination, but it is deep and dark and scary. David clearly expects to emerge the other side, from its shadows into the light on the other side. David was close to death and defeat on several occasions. He intimately knew that God was with him in those moments. Even more encouraging is the fact that we face only shadows of death because Jesus took full reality of death in our place. And because of this, saints can calmly walk through whatever he or she is facing. Charles Spurgeon said, death in its substance has been removed, and only the shadow of it remains. The words are not in the future tense, and therefore are not reserved for a distant moment. The shepherd's presence did not eliminate the presence of evil, but certainly the fear of evil. Isaiah 43, 1 through 3. Don't be afraid, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned, and flame will not scorch you. For I am Yahweh, your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. The Hebrew word for valley is more than just a valley. It's a deep and narrow gorge. It's dark, it's frightening, and there are only two ways to go, back from where you came, or to continue on. There's no other exit. Valley comes from the root word that actually means arrogance and pride. Carolyn touched on that this morning. It describes a person who puts up high walls around himself, spreading himself off, shutting himself off from the outside world like a gorge. This verse reminds me of 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has overtaken you except as is common to man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make a way of escape that you will be able to bear it. Let me share something with you. The enemy tries to make us give up. Satan is prideful and he's arrogant. Very attributes that got him kicked out of heaven. Satan tries to make us follow suit. But Satan is not all-knowing, and he makes a lot of mistakes. And he underestimates the saints and God.
Amen.
The proof of God's love is not that he allows bad things to happen. It's that he will be there with you when they do. Dr. Clyde Cook, a missionary, said, "Safety is not the absence of danger, but the presence of the Lord." For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. God is talking about comfort. This clearly means we fear no evil, for God is with us. Two of the shepherd's most important tools were his rod and his staff. David was not comforted because he saw or imagined Jesus beside him holding a rod and staff and was ready to whack his adversaries. David was the one holding the rod and the staff. Likewise, it's the same for Moses in the Bible. When he was afraid and had no confidence that he could deliver God's people, God gave Moses a rod. In Exodus 4:17, he said, "And thou shalt take this rod in thy hand, wherewith thou shalt do signs." If you truly study the Hebrew words for rod and staff in the Hebrew, sometimes they seem to be used interchangeably, but there is a difference. The rod and the staff are two separate but equally important pieces of equipment. The rod speaks of correction and power, while the staff, which is basically a walking stick, speaks of authority and support. What should comfort us today is that we go through these valleys and trials. The rod and staff are not in the Lord's hands, but his authority, his power, and support are placed in our hands, just like he did for Moses and for David. Most times the rod was a symbol of correction, and the staff represented protection. The staff is thought of as a mental persuasion, while the rod is of a physical one. The rod, typically made of specific shepherd, had a weighted head the shape of a light bulb. If necessary, the shepherd could throw it with great accuracy toward the predator and warn it away. He might even use it as a weapon against the predator. The shepherd might also use the rod gently to press into the sheep's side to guide the animal along the path. And the staff, that is one with the crook or hook on it. And it was used to guide especially stubborn sheep in a way that was firm but still gentle. The hook could also be used to lift sheep from precarious situations that they got themselves into. God brings back the sheep, who have wandered off or strayed with the crook of the staff. Micah 7:14, shepherd your people with your staff. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. God is talking about substance. Rabbi Rimanoff lived from 1745 to 1815. And he likened this verse to the manna that God gave us, that God gave the Jews in the desert. On Sabbath, a double portion fell from heaven. In fact, this is why there are two challahs at each Shabbat dinner, reminding the Jews of the miracle of the manna and how even now, just like then, God provides for us. To be invited to a person's table was an honor. To be invited to the king's table was a great honor. But to be invited to God's table is the ultimate honor. To eat at the king's table in the presence of your enemies would show your enemies that the king holds you in high regard and would demonstrate their powerlessness to hurt you. Jesus honored his disciples by inviting them to a table where he served them bread, saying, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it until you fulfill the kingdom of God. In the presence of his enemies, Jesus broke bread with his disciples. Communion is prepared for us as defense and counterattack against our enemies. You can fight sickness, depression, addiction, or whatever enemy you're facing with communion. It is one of the greatest weapons we have. David's point was that the Lord floods, overflows our lives with blessings. When our eyes are on the Lord instead of the enemy, our troubles, the circumstances of our lives cannot keep the Lord from blessing us. Ephesians 3:20, far more abundantly beyond all that we can ask or think, as Paul wrote. The Lord not only helps us through our daily troubles, but blesses us despite these obstacles by supernaturally empowering us through his peace, comfort, and contentment. The Apostle Paul refers to this in Philippians 4:7. Jesus promised us in John 10:10 that he came to give us life and have it more abundantly. This wasn't just for material things, but every area of our life. You anoint my head with oil. God is speaking of anointing here. Anointing someone with oil was an act of hospitality. Anointing oil was also used for the sick, and it was applied to injuries. Christians anointed themselves to revive or energize their bodies. Other verses can definitely refer to the anointing of David to one day become king. David knew that shepherds also used oil to heal and their sheep's cuts. Oil kept out parasites, infections, and soothes the wounds and insect bites. When we stay under the anointing of God, he protects us. When we find ourselves with cuts and bruises, we need to sit under and be administered to by God's anointing oil. Anointing with oil was used for a variety of purposes, for healing, for burial, expressing grief, and even expressions of joy. In the Bible, anointing was used to designate a person for a significant role. Prophets were anointed, priests were anointed, kings were anointed. Jesus was anointed. Jesus was anointed to set himself apart for his unique role as prophet, priest, and king, and even death. When David said that God has anointed his head with oil, he meant that God has marked him as special. He had set him apart for a significant position. God set David apart as king when Samuel anointed him with oil. But remember, it was quite a number of years that passed before David actually sat on the throne of Israel. However, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from the day he was anointed. My cup runneth over, abundance. This means overflowing with wealth. And it comes from the root word meaning to fill and satisfy. The Lord doesn't just give people what they need. He provides for his saints with abundance. The idea portrayed here is that God will provide everything that his followers need and his abundance will be displayed in front of your enemies, bringing them to jealousy. Our enemies should realize that they have no hold over us and they are unable to win.
Amen.
The overflowing cup symbolizes Lord's generosity. There are no halfway measures when it comes to the Lord's provision for our lives. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life. We're talking about confidence here. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. John 10:11. In fact, earlier in John 10:4, John describes how the shepherd goes before the sheep and the sheep follow him. As believers in Christ Jesus of Nazareth, we are assured of where we will be spending eternity. I know most of you know that we aren't to pursue the blessings. We are to pursue the blesser, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. As you pursue him, we don't have to be concerned about blessings because they'll follow after you. In fact, the Hebrew translation of Psalm 23:6 is much stronger and more aggressive. It literally says, "Surely goodness and mercy shall hunt me down all the days of my life." I've heard it described as goodness and mercy runs after you, as the pastor just said, pursuing you, hunting you down, trying to overtake you. However, the Hebrew word for follow is even stronger than I realized. It also means harassing. It said that we are pursued by mercy. We are chased by grace. Goodness and mercy are known as twin sisters. We never deserve grace. And God's mercy is that when he looks at us, he sees his son. Amen?
Amen.
You see, we all mess up. David messed up a lot. He knew firsthand God's grace and mercy. And I would dwell on the house of the Lord forever. We're talking about union here. In Judaism, the commandments are the way of defining your relationship with God. The way you eat, the way you use your words, and the way you treat other people. Psalm 23 is a prayer for guidance, God's guidance. It's revelation of who God is. It is a promise of what we have in Christ. Psalm 23 is a reminder of the power and victory we walk in daily. Psalm 23 is a weapon that destroys worry, stress, and anxiety. Psalm 23 is a morning prayer to set our steps for the rest of the day. Psalm 23 is for you, a gift from God so that you can walk with him and achieve your destiny. Psalm 23 came from the core of David's being, and we will need to read it and make it our own with all the power that David shared. Amen. You have given us such power and might, that you are with us, that you are our Lord, our Savior, our provider, our defender, and that you have empowered us to take authority over our lives, over our situation, over our nation, over anything that would come against us, Father, that you have provided a table before our enemies, a banquet, Father, that will cause our enemies to be jealous, Father, to desire what we have, to desire you. Father, let us walk in this anointing, that we can portray you the way you want to be portrayed, that we can walk humbly and with love and with the power of the Holy Spirit, that we would say the right things and do the right things, and if we don't, that you are quick to forgive us. Father, I thank you for making this church shine and walk through their destiny, that all will achieve what you have placed for us to do. We just give you the glory and honor and praise, and thank you for empowering us. In Jesus' mighty name.